So hello friends, in this video we shall discuss hash MeToo movement. So the hash MeToo movement, which began as a hashtag on Twitter in 2017, has become a global phenomenon. Now following the outrage, that is a global outrage over the Harvey Weinstein incident in the West, where the noted Hollywood producer was accused of sexual harassment by over 70 women. So 70 women in the West accused this fellow Harvey Weinstein, who is a film producer, you can say a Hollywood film producer, in 2017. Now following this global outrage, the hash MeToo movement, which has finally arrived in India, is engulfing the whole media and entertainment industry. So this fellow who is a Hollywood film producer was accused of sexual harassment by over 70 women. 70 is a great number, and this fellow must be severely punished, you can say. So over the last several days, so that means after 2017, and when it entered into India, or we can say finally arrived in India, and over the last several days, a number of women in India have called out influential men, and these men can be actors or stand-up comics, or you can say senior journalists. So several women in India have called out influential men for alleged sexual harassment. So they have said their allegations over the sexual harassment they faced, and they have called out several influential men, and these influential men are having the professions of they are carrying the profession of actors, stand-up comics and senior journalists. Now under what law is sexual harassment at the workplace covered in India? So if you see, the sexual harassment of women at workplace act was passed in 2013. So the sexual harassment of women at workplace act was passed in 2013, and this act basically features prevention, prohibition and redressal. Okay, prevention, prohibition and redressal, it defines. So this act, that is a sexual harassment of women at workplace act, defines what is sexual harassment. It lays down procedures for a complaint and inquiry and the action to be taken. It also broadens the Vishakha guidelines, which were already in place. So we shall see what are the Vishakha guidelines in the later part. Now, how does this Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act defines sexual harassment? Okay, how does this act defines sexual harassment? So sexual harassment includes anyone or more of I will explain what are the behavior or unwelcome acts which will come under the sexual harassment. So the sexual harassment includes any one or more of the following, you can say, unwelcome acts or unwelcome behavior committed directly or by implication. So the acts can be directly committed or they may be implied acts. So unwelcome acts or the behavior which comes under the sexual harassment. So the first one is the physical contact and advances. So you all know what is the meaning of contact, and advances means drawing nearer to a woman, or you can say approaching to a woman or pushing on to women. So the physical contact and advances is one unwelcome behavior, and the second one is a demand. It can be demand or request for sexual favors, demand or request from request of sexual favors. And the third one is sexually colored remarks. So this meaning is, actually the definition has not been elaborated under this act, but you can say they are subtle references to sex. So sexually colored remarks are, they are subtle references to sex. And the fourth unwelcome behavior is showing pornography, that is blue films. And the fifth one is any other unwelcome physical or verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature. So these five things were these five things are coming under the unwelcome acts or behavior. So that is the important thing to note, is even the sexual colored remarks are in the ambit of the sexual harassment of women at workplace act. The sexual colored remarks are nothing but the subtle references to sex. So please remember this. One is the physical contact and advances, and the demand or request for sexual favors, and sexually colored remarks, showing pornography. And the fifth one is any unwelcome behavior, that is covering physical, verbal and non-verbal conduct of sexual nature. Now let us see what were the Vishakha guidelines. Okay, what were the Vishakha guidelines? So following the hash Me Too movement, the Supreme Court has broadened the Vishakha guidelines. Now let us see what were the guidelines before the Supreme Court broadening the Vishakha guidelines. So these guidelines were laid down by the Supreme Court in 1997. So basically the Vishakha guidelines were laid down by the Supreme Court in a judgment in 1997, and these guidelines came because of a case filed by women's rights groups, and one of these women's rights groups was Vishakha. So there was a women's rights group named as Vishakha. So there were several women's rights groups filed a case, and one of them was Vishakha, and the name comes from this women's rights group Vishakha. So thereby they are called as the Vishakha guidelines, as the case was filed by several women's rights groups and one among them was Vishakha. So the women's rights group was Vishakha, and they had filed a PIL, that is public interest litigation, over the alleged gang rape of Bhanwari Devi, a social worker from Rajasthan. So they filed a PIL over the alleged gang rape. So please remember, it is a gang rape. It was a gang rape on Bhanwari Devi, a social worker from Rajasthan. Now why this gang rape was happened? So the gang rape was happened in a revenge, because in 1992, Bhanwari Devi prevented the marriage of 1 year old girl, leading to the alleged gang rape in an act of revenge. So as she prevented the marriage of a 1 year old girl, she was gang raped in an act of revenge over preventing the marriage of that 1 year old girl. So how cheap some Indians are behaving. They are marrying even 1 year old girl. So that is so cheap mentality of some of the Indians. Now what do these guidelines say? What do these Vishakha guidelines say? So these Vishakha guidelines are legally binding. So these Vishakha guidelines are legally binding. These defined sexual harassment and imposed three key obligations. So they impose three key obligations: must do things on institutions, and they are prohibition, prevention, and redress. Redress means inquiring about the complaint and giving justice. So prevention, prohibition, and redress, three obligations on institutions. So the guidelines impose these three key obligations on institutions, and it also defined the sexual harassment. So the Supreme Court directed that they establish a complaints committee which would look into matters of sexual harassment of women at the workplace. It mandates that every employer constitute an internal complaints committee at each office or branch with 10 or more employees. That means the employer must constitute an internal complaints committee at each office or branch which is having the 10 or more employees. Now, is there a time frame within which the complaint has to be made? So let us see, is there any time frame within which the complaint has to be made? Yes, the act states that the complaint of sexual harassment has to be made within 3 months from the date of incidents. Okay, within 3 months, the sexual harassment complaint must be made within 3 months from the date of the incident, and for a series of incidents, it has to be made within 3 months from the date of last incident. If I say first incident has occurred, and again second incident has occurred, that is a sexual harassment incident, and again third incident has occurred, then from this third incident following 3 months, you will be given time for the complaints to be made. Now, this is however not rigid, because the ICC can extend the time limit, not exactly 3 months, it can extend the time limit if it is satisfied that the circumstances were such which prevented the women from filing a complaint within a set period. The ICC is to record these reasons. So the ICC can note the circumstances under which the women is not able to file the complaint within the set period. So it can extend the time limit. Okay, this is the time frame under which the complaint has to be made under the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act. Now, what happens if a complaint is found to be false? So let us say a woman has filed a false complaint. Now, what happens to the women? Now, Section 14 of the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act deals with the punishment for false or malicious, that is ill-natured complaint on false evidence. In such a case, the ICC can recommend to the employer that it can take action against the woman or the person who has made the complaint in accordance with the provisions of the service rules. So that means the ICC can recommend to the employer. So then each employer who is having a office or branch of 10 or more employees must constitute an internal complaints committee, and this internal complaints committee might recommend the employer for the false evidence, or you can say malicious complaint, and the employer can take action in accordance with the provision of the service rules. So this is all about the #MeToo movement, which is required for the UPSC mains. I hope you understood well. Thank you.